Tonight, part one of our new serial, South Africa, the legacy of apartheid.
Tonight, we officially launch the Explore South Africa 1995 campaign.
What you can capture here in a first world sense, you'll never be able to capture in Disney World or Toronto or any other place, or Australia for that matter.
300 journalists invited by the South African Tourist Board, SATUR, to help sell post-apartheid South Africa as an attractive tourist destination.
I think I'm going to buy a little condo right over there somewhere.
Cameraman Tom Adetuyi and I were among a group of 52 from North America. It was a busy 8 days, in and out of airports, five-star hotels, and endless bus tours. Just enough to give one a glimpse of the good, the bad, and the ugly. The country on the southern extreme of Africa, a country well known for apartheid, which kept it isolated from the rest of the world. Now that apartheid is officially over, at least on paper, South Africa is inviting the world to visit.
Nowhere in the world can one find, in a single country, such diversity of scenic beauty, wildlife, and cultures.
You get a better view of Robben Island now.
Is that Robben Island?
That's Robben Island.
Is this where Mandela spent most of the time?
Correct.
Right there?
Over 20 years, yes.
That's where the prison is.
That's right.
Cape Town in the Cape Province is a must for any visitor. The magnificent Table Mountain dominates the landscape. Attractions include a seal colony that's a short boat ride from Hot Bay. These seals are in their natural habitat. The scenery along the Atlantic coastline is breathtaking. You'll find some of the most expensive and exclusive real estate here. This is where whites live.
This is a place called Clifton, just outside Cape Town. Now, you need a lot of money to live out here. Look at these homes.
In the old South Africa, people like me were not allowed to live here, except in specific areas designated under the old Group Areas Act. They tell me that's all changed, but not for the people who live in places like this, also part of Cape Town. We were warned to visit at our own risk. Tom and I took the chance and made some new friends.
I'm not working. I eat some bones.
Like, you look all right. Look at this.
You will meet them later. The Cape is also famous for its wines. This is the headquarters for the Liquor Control Board. Wine estates have daily tours and tasting, not to mention fabulous restaurants.
The city of Durban in the Natal province is well known for its beautiful beaches. This stretch is in a place called Umhlanga. It's midday. The temperature is about between 75 and 80 degrees Fahrenheit. There's a cool, warm breeze blowing inland from the Indian Ocean. The locals here call this a bad day.
This is the Indian market. It's famous for the curry powder, the curios, and very, very important, it's got different cultures around here.
Is that right?
Yeah.
It's a fascinating place.
Yeah, this is, if you haven't visited the Indian market, you haven't seen Durban.
Johannesburg, the largest and the most cosmopolitan city in South Africa. A visit to a native African medicine shop was an interesting experience.
You talk about black magic then?
Yes.
Does it work?
Yes, it works.
I put it in my mouth and I talk to somebody right away,
somebody,
they agree
maybe
to what I want.
Maybe you talk about business, whatever
business,
you want
money.
Him to buy business.
I want my boss to hear this. Steve, you heard this? If I chew this thing and I talk to you during negotiations, any money I want, you're going to give to me.
Yeah.
Right?
after several members of our group insisted on visiting a black community, our host quickly arranged a tour of Soweto.
This is the school that started the riots in 1976.
And we finally got a tour guide who told it like it is. A brief stop at a local beer hall, popularly known as Shebeen's.
In Soweto as a whole, there are more than 150,000 licensed Shebeen's. And there are more than 1 million unlicensed Shebeen's. Most of the millionaires from Soweto, they've made their money out of the Shebeen's, out of the taxis.
And now they live in places like this. After Soweto, it was off to Sun City and a visit to a little-known national park where we witnessed one of the most unusual scenes during our whirlwind tour. A standoff between a lion and a young rhino guarding the carcass of its mother.
How long has this been going on?
About 3 days now. There is water close by, so I have no doubt both of them are drinking. But eating is going to be the problem. It depends on who gives up first.
By 1996, the annual number of visitors to South Africa should reach at least 4.5 million. And by the year 2000, it must be 9 million.
Even under apartheid, tourism was a major foreign exchange source for South Africa. 6 billion rands, 3 billion Canadian dollars in revenue. The country is now counting on tourist dollars and other foreign investors to stimulate a sluggish economy and help create jobs and bankroll much-needed reforms and hopefully improve the lives of millions expecting a miracle from the Mandela-led ANC government.
And be here tomorrow night for part two of South Africa, The Legacy of Apartheid, when JoJo takes us on an unofficial tour of the townships. Time now for part two in our City Pulse News serial, South Africa, The Legacy of Apartheid. JoJo Chintoh's video chronicle of his recent trip to that long, troubled land. Last night, Joe showed us some of the beauty that is South Africa, but tonight he puts away his tour map to give us a whole different perspective.
We are at the moment in Crossroads. This is Crossroads, yes.
Katz Rahim, taxi owner, driver, and unofficial tour guide.
Do you think the election of the new government will make a difference in these people's lives?
Most definitely, sir. It won't be immediately, but most definitely. You could see the change. People are actually feeling much more free now. They are feeling better at the moment. But obviously, now, nothing happens overnight.
Initially, our official tour of Cape Town did not include places like this. So, cameraman Tom Adetuyi and I decided to break away from the pack and check out the so-called squatter camps for ourselves.
I'm from Canada, can I talk to you for a minute?
Communities like Langa, Nyanga, Guguletu, and Kailicha.
This is my place, 740.
740, you live right here?
Yes, yes,
this is pretty nice.
We talked to Wiseman Ngubetole, one of the doormen at our hotel, the Cape Sun.
How long have you lived here?
3 years.
3 years.
Wiseman doesn't own a car, so he called on his old friend Katz to help us out.
Now, Langa, L-A-N-G-A, if you translate that, it means the sun. Then we have Nyanga, which means the moon. Then we have Guguletu, our pride. These are the three main townships that we've had previously. Then, of course, Khayelitsha is our residence, our abode.
Khayelitsha is the newest of what our official tour guide politely calls informal housing.
But if you look at it, you'll see how far from new it is.
Home to some 750,000 native Africans.
Those that lived here, you see they have a little better homes. Many of them have come from the so-called homelands previously, basically looking for work.
representing more than 90% of South Africa's 40 million plus people. They are also the source of cheap labor, exploited to create much of the wealth and the good life enjoyed by whites and other privileged groups.
Now, shanty towns like this are on the outskirts of just about every major urban center here in South Africa. The most famous is Soweto. These houses, what does it look like inside? Do you have any water there?
Nothing inside there.
Any toilet facilities?
There's a toilet.
Right here?
Yes. A toilet.
That's all?
Unemployment among Africans living under these conditions is staggering. 49% or better. 70% cannot read or write and have no skills.
The job, okay, and the house is not good. No.
So the first thing is you need a job, you need a house.
Yes.
That's the first thing.
Yes. Is job.
Free education.
What do you want?
Free education.
The strategy was, get them, try and keep education away from them. Obviously, then you get basic labor, cheap labor.
They tell me they used to live under constant scrutiny of security forces who made sure they stayed in their place.
What kind of problems do you have around here?
The taxi drivers.
They shoot at the taxi drivers?
Yeah, the taxi drivers are shooting from the buses.
The taxi drivers are shooting at the buses?
Yeah.
Why are they shooting at the buses? Pardon?
Customers.
So they're fighting for control.
In post-apartheid South Africa, these soldiers are helping keep black gangs from killing each other. At stake, the lucrative taxi business. Visible from the highway is the construction of a new wall concealing the squatter camps. Our official tour guide claims the wall is to keep out livestock and to prevent residents from crossing the highway.
What they do is try and keep themselves protected now.
Kats Rahim believes the wall is simply an attempt by the authorities to hide the ugly legacy of apartheid.
For Nelson Mandela and his ANC government to succeed, this wall must come down. Do you guys go to school?
Yes.
Yes.
Do you go to school? What grades are you in?
Standard
8.
Sub B, sub C.
I am standard 3.
Standard 3. What about you?
Class
1A. Class
1A? Yes.
What about you? Class 3.
Class
and you?
Two.
No, you're too small for 3. What are you going to be when you grow up? Do you know what you're going to be when you grow up? Why can't they tell me what they want to be when they grow up?
I don't know. To be very honest, they don't know because they haven't been... Look at it, the lack of education has created this problem.
All the people want in these areas here, they want a better standard of living, they want better jobs, they want better education for the children. That's all. I mean, that is not something, hell of a thing to ask for. It's basic commodities they want.
Residents in places like Khayelitsha are now hoping the new Mandela government would provide them with those basic necessities, something the white apartheid government neglected to do.
It'll go a long way in keeping hope alive and relieving some of the daily stress and tension in communities like Khayelitsha. I'm JoJo Chintoh in Khayelitsha, outside Cape Town in South Africa for City Pulse.
South Africans expect changes from their new political reality, but will those changes really come and how quickly? JoJo asks those tough questions in part 3 at this time tomorrow night. Time now for part 3 of our City Pulse News serial, South Africa, the Legacy of Apartheid. Beauty, promise, change. JoJo Chintoh found all 3 of those during his recent visit to South Africa, and tonight more from the people and more of their hopes.
What does the new South Africa mean to you?
New South Africa. Right now, I hear about the new South Africa is coming, but I never see what new South Africa. Because you see, I'm still the same like before. The government should help us because we're poor.
How should it help you?
Maybe should find a job for us, build a house for us.
He is in his late 20s and just one of millions of South Africa's unemployed. Where do you live?
I live in the bush.
You live in the bush?
Yeah.
What do you mean you live in the bush?
No, because I've got no house. That's why I live in the bush.
Do you have a house in the bush?
No, I just got the blanket and the cardboard to sleep on the bush.
What is this? Look at this.
Helping the people to show them the parking.
Or you help people show them the parking?
Yes.
And they give you a tip?
Yes, a tip.
And that's how you make some money?
Yes.
In a pre-enterprise world now, because everything before, we can't do what we do now.
Yeah.
But now we do a living.
What are you doing? You're selling this?
I'm selling this.
Are you working for yourself?
I'm working for myself.
Where do you get this from? Are you doing the same thing?
Yeah. Or are we working together?
Where do you live?
I'm living on the street.
You live on the street?
I'm living on the street. This is the way I can find an honest living on the street without begging for money.
For Cape Town street vendor Michael Bull, the new South Africa means freedom to go anywhere without fear of arrest or harassment. What do you expect Nelson Mandela's government to do for you?
Well, what he actually wants, I suspect, is only the promises he makes for us who haven't got a job. Next year, the 6 months, we get a job.
Now look, it took years to get to this stage. How can you expect him to clean up the problem or rectify the problem in 1 year?
No, we must wait. We must wait.
Can you wait?
We can wait. We can wait. So long things come right.
You've worked for 3 years as a casual worker here in this hotel.
Yes.
Do you have any other work?
No.
Nelly Tom, 26, single mom with two kids, makes R3.50 an hour, about $1.50 Canadian, as cleaner at the Cape Sun Hotel. She tells me she has worked steadily for 3 years and is still classified as casual worker. She has no benefits and can be fired anytime. Her request to the new government, pay equity.
We want to be equal like the whites, what they get,
yeah.
Because whites get more than us.
Of course.
They take blacks as a cheap labor.
You guys provide the cheap labor in this country.
Yeah.
Of course. Of course.
And how do you feel about that?
We feel very bad because there's no changes yet.
So this is where you live?
Yes, sir. This is where I live.
Christopher Sinkoto, 33, is the homeowner in a new housing development for Native Africans.
Are you living here? Yes, I'm living here and you are welcome.
I'm JoJo.
Nokaya. Yeah.
Is this your wife?
This is my wife, yeah.
Okay, good. What's your name?
It's Nokaya.
Nokaya.
Yeah.
Nokaya. Okay, great. Let's show me your house here for me.
So, okay,
yeah,
fine.
This is
my sitting room.
This is your,
yeah. Yeah. These are my kids.
What do you want to be when you grow up?
Yeah, I can translate it for them.
They don't speak English?
No, no.
Do they go to school?
They are going to school, but they are not taught English. So I can translate it.
Okay, then ask them what
they want. Where are you going to go? Where are you going to go? Where are you going
to go?
Yeah, this one wants to be a doctor.
When
you want to be a teacher, this one.
When
I'm under. You go ahead. Yeah? She wants to be a lawyer, this one.
You want to be a lawyer?
Oh. Right.
So what is this? Oh, that's the buski.
Yeah, that's what we call it. You call the buski and we call it a shebeen in South Africa.
Family earns extra cash from a shebeen or buskan.
Do you guys work?
Yeah.
Where do you work?
I'm in the force, police force.
But with the police force? You're a police officer. You're sitting in an illegal bar. You have no license. Are you going to arrest him?
No.
How much are you worth?
No ways.
I'm worthless.
This is a pretty fancy car. How many people like you and I, Africans, are doing well in this country, in this economy?
I think quite a lot of them. See, if you take the whole total population of 30 million people,
mm-hmm.
we're talking about... I'm giving a rough estimation.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 10% of the total population is doing well.
Even by white standards, Lucky Nkosi is well off. How come you could do well in spite of apartheid?
How can I do well? You could work hard.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you work hard and then really achieve and it depends on your schooling too. Mm-hmm. I went for South African Brothers for more than 11 years, mm-hmm. 12 years I would say. Then I went on my own, I run my own company mm-hmm. for about 5 years. Because of sanctions, number one, I used to import hair care products from America. Uh-huh, uh-huh. Because of sanctions and the rate of exchange, our... Uh-huh.
So you're basically an entrepreneur?
Yes, I am. Yeah,
you're a businessman?
I'm a businessman.
What do you think should be the priority of the ANC government, the new government?
Well, first priority, let's wait. There are three priorities. It's education, number one, health and housing.
What about jobs?
Well, that will create jobs. I mean, the apartheid system has done damage in this country for the past 46 years. Mm-hmm. And we expect Mandela to solve it within a year's time or 5 years' time. It's impossible. But he can try. That I know. I believe in him. And I've got a strong feeling and a strong belief that Mandela will try.
Yeah. Fight and those fight. Yeah. But they're not going to take us nowhere. No. Let us come down and sit together and then solve the problems.
And then you don't really bear any malice towards the white people who've oppressed you all these years.
Mustn't much think about those. Let us sit down and talk. And then they're going to see themselves where their mistakes is. Where
and if this can improve, they can arrange better homes and facilities for the poor people. We don't need to fight. We want to grow. We see the world is actually focused in South Africa. They're going to help us all the way. For us fighting, our people are not going to come in. They're not going to invest in the country. So very strongly we believe that by carrying on doing things peacefully, hoping, God willing, it's going to work out for us.
But will whites and blacks really share the wealth in the new South Africa? That's in JoJo's conclusion tomorrow night. And now the conclusion of our City Pulse News serial, South Africa, the Legacy of Apartheid. Tonight, JoJo Chintoh talks with South Africans about their hopes for social and financial equality in a country so long divided.
We need tourists. We need tourism. Without tourism, you can't boost your the economy of whatever country. You understand? We're talking about Kenya. Kenya, as far as tourism is concerned, they're rated number one in Africa. You understand? They're making their money on tourism. So we need tourism. We need people like you to come and spend their dollars here.
If we come across children throwing stones at us, all we got to do is stop the minibus, go out of the minibus, and throw the stones back to them.
I think it's ridiculous that people come and say, we want to visit to Soweto. Just as a curiosity, we are not animals in the townships. We should to say, okay, this is a waiter. Here's a little canteen or a little fast food. You can get some food and courier shops and handicrafts. That, in that way, the foreign exchange that the tourist is coming down with, we're going to get some droplets of it.
That is the focus of the tourism campaign that brought us and other journalists from around the world to South Africa.
This campaign called Tourism Share the Rewards was launched at the beginning of this year and will reach its peak during the second half of this year.
More than any other country on this continent, South Africa has the potential to become number one for travelers looking for an exotic destination with first world comforts at bargain prices.
We have come to accept the fact that tourism is a major engine of growth, the multiplier effect, both in terms of employment and foreign exchange earning, is one in which any agency concerned with development has to play a role. Globally, one out of every 16 jobs now is from the sector.
Let's check this place out. You don't believe it. This is where I spend the night. What a spot. $300 US night. Of course, Tom stayed in a similar room on the other side called the Leopard's Wing. This is the Lion's Wing. At hotels, resorts, and game parks, there is a lot of evidence of the potential for tourism to create jobs.
Our job would be to provide or to bring to the attention of the investors business opportunities at the community level.
Dr. Ken Kwaku of the World Bank is one of several consultants and experts working with the tourism board to ensure money generated by the industry trickles down to those in need.
I want to be able to show the world community, whether it's Japanese, Malaysians, Nigerians, or Americans, that if you invest in a restaurant or a disco in Soweto, or whether you invest in a tour program in Soweto, whether it's Chris Hani's house or whatever, using the, you know, the monuments of the revolution, there's money to be made, you know, and that money goes back into the community. That is what we are trying to do.
South Africa and Southern Africa has the best to offer to the international tourism market. It's got the wonderful climate, it's got wildlife, it's got scenic beauty, and people want to have those experiences, and the money that's flowing in through that, our biggest challenge is to ensure that that actually flows down to the people where it's most needed.
People like you have benefited of, you know, of the labor of the blacks in here. Are you prepared to share the wealth?
Absolutely, and we want to do that, and we want to be proactive in doing that.
We shouldn't get a slice of the cake. I want to be, we should be part of the recipe making in the cake.
It's a concept Dr. Kwaku and other experts endorse. And they say that's what's going to make the difference if South Africa is to succeed.
Anytime that you do things for people, with that, they never appreciate it, truthfully. I think it is important to get people to be part of creating their own destiny, to, I mean, set the agenda by themselves.
We are the future.
If the words of these children and the mood at the ceremony launching the campaign to share the wealth are any indication, the future of South Africa certainly looks bright.
Going to the Molson Indy this weekend, looking for some sunshine.